early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb, and the two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then his disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. So one thing you'll notice, the difference between Matthew and John, is that in Matthew you've got two Marys going to the tomb, and in this one you just got Mary Magdalene. And also, in this one, you have Mary coming and seeing that the tomb is empty and freaking out and going and running and telling the disciples, right? And Peter, as is often the case, goes off half-cocked to do something, right? So Peter goes running off towards the tomb. Unfortunately, Peter's a little old, okay? And Peter's running with this beloved disciple that you hear about time and time again in John, this disciple whom Jesus loved. And this disciple was presumably younger and could do a 40-yard dash a little bit faster than Peter. And so you have this image of this older guy running, and he's huffing and puffing, and he's doing pretty good at first. And then comes the young guy just right on by him, right? But because he's respectful, the beloved disciple just looks into the tomb. And what does he see? He sees, first of all, Mary's not crazy. You know, they must have thought she was nuts when she came back and said, "The tomb is empty, somebody's taken his body," right? Well, but they saw the stone get rolled in front of it, and the bodies just don't get up and walk out, right? But they get there and they see that it's empty. And then Peter comes puffing up behind, and he's made it to the tomb, and he just goes on and barges in, right? And he sees for himself that the tomb is empty. And Peter and the beloved disciple see that the tomb is empty. And what do? Do they go and tell everybody Jesus is risen? Do they proclaim from the rooftops that Christ has defeated death and sin and that they need to start telling everybody about it? No, what do? They go home. That's right. These wonderful, brilliant men who have followed Jesus their whole adult lives, right? It's 3 years. This most important, significant time of their lives. They followed the Son of God all over the place. They see that he's risen from the dead, and they go back home. But Mary stays because they don't bother to explain to her. It says the younger disciple stops and sees and believes, but doesn't say anything to Mary. And they leave her back in the garden weeping because she's convinced somebody has stolen the body of Jesus. And imagine how much that must have hurt. Because she's got all these things going in her head, all these ideas of what these grave robbers have done with the body of Jesus. Not bad enough that this man who had come and had saved her from her life had changed her, and she had become one of his disciples, right? She doesn't get counted in the 12 because they liked that number 12. And also because, you know, the people who wrote the Bible were probably dudes, okay? And they tended to focus on the men. Okay. That's why the feeding of the 5,000 is, you know, probably more than that. Right? But she was with them. There's so many stories where Mary Magdalene is present, right? She's like the fifth Beatle. She's there a lot. She loves Jesus. She anointed his feet with the oil. Remember the expensive oil that Judas was mad about? She loved Jesus. And for her to hear, to see that his body was gone, and to believe that somebody had taken it, stolen it, and was doing Lord knows what with it, it's heartbreaking to her. And so she's sitting there in the garden weeping until the gardener starts talking to her. And this would be, you know, a great little moment for humor if it wasn't that, you know, she's so sad. Jesus is there in her presence, but she thinks he must be the gardener. She says, if you've taken my Lord, please tell me. And does he say anything big and fancy and amazing to her to make her recognize who he was? He calls her by her name. And Mary doesn't have to run to the tomb, doesn't have to run to Jesus. Why? Because she never left. Mary stayed. And she turns and she embraces him, and he has to say, don't cling to me because I have not ascended to the Father just yet. She's so happy, she's so joyful that she's latched on to Jesus and she's not going to let him go. So in this wonderful, wonderful story this morning, we have three different reactions to the news that the tomb was empty. We have three different people. We have Mary, we have Peter, and the beloved disciple. Two of them have been hiding out in the upper room, scared to come out. When they hear that the tomb is empty, they take off running. Some of you in your life have taken off running to Jesus, right? At one time in your life, you were a long way off from him, and you weren't ready to meet him, and you weren't sure about all this Jesus stuff. But then you heard about him, you met him, and you wanted to learn, and you went taking off running. And maybe you were that young disciple who outdistanced other people around you, and you blew by them, and you were ready to come to the altar. You were ready to know Jesus. You were ready to be a part of the family of God. Maybe you were a little bit more like Peter, where slow and steady, worn down by the things of life, but you still were coming to Jesus. Maybe you've been like Mary, always there with Jesus, always following, but not always completely understanding everything, right? She's there in the presence of the empty tomb at this amazing monumental moment and doesn't really know what's happened. But she's the first to glimpse the risen Christ, the first to hold Jesus after he is risen from the dead. A wonderful, wonderful blessing. And so this morning, what I want you to think of is that it's not just Mary and Peter and the beloved disciple who have the opportunity to run to Jesus. You and me can run to Jesus today. Throughout our lives at different times, maybe you are like this today. We get dried out. We get worn out by life. We get sequestered and locked into little rooms of our own worries, of our own concerns, of pain and suffering and death and frustration and just life. We get locked into those little rooms. Jesus is always there. Sometimes it seems dark. Imagine Holy Saturday. We never do anything really on Holy Saturday, do we? We do Good Friday and then we do Easter sunrise service. Imagine what Holy Saturday was like for those disciples. Not knowing if there was going to be a knock at the door at any time, and would be dragged out by the priests and the scribes and the Pharisees, or if they would be taken by the Romans, if they would share a cross with Jesus after the Passover was over. So no wonder they stayed hidden in the upper room. But I don't want to trivialize the troubles that we have in our own lives. We each have heartbreaks. We each have darkness. And sometimes we wonder where the light is in life. Well, folks, Easter morning reminds us that darkness looked like it won on Good Friday. But then the light came spilling from the tomb. And when they looked at Jesus, they didn't recognize him because he looked a little different. He was risen. He was shining. He was bright. They suspected him to be the gardener, to be an angel, to be all kinds of different things because he's being shown as what he is, the light of the world. So this morning, I want you to, in your heart, run to Jesus. Whether it's your own sin, whether it's our own laziness, whether it's our own, whether it's life that has beaten you down and gotten you farther away from Christ, today on Easter morning, join with Peter, join with the beloved disciple, and run to Jesus. You may have to hobble and stumble, but run to Jesus. Because you'll find that the risen Christ is worth the effort. The risen Christ is always there, ready to show us that light, to show us that love. Amen? And this morning, we have the opportunity not necessarily to run to the table, although you're welcome to do so if you would like, but to come to the table and to share in the meal that he prepared for his disciples. And you may not be physically running. Some of you may be slowly moving and having some help. That's fine. But in your heart, run to Christ. Take Christ's body and Christ's blood. Feel his presence. Know that you are welcomed, regardless of what has gone on in your life, regardless of all the things that have happened yesterday to the beginning of your life, regardless of what's going to happen tomorrow, that Jesus loves you, that this table belongs to Jesus, and that your brother invites you to come.